I'm Gary DeWitt from Spear Education. I'm here with some of my best friends. This is some of my articulators. I've been collecting articulators for a number of years. I'd like to spend a few minutes and give you a couple of tips about using this with an articulator. This is an earbow. But first, let me talk a little bit about articulators. Semi-adjustable articulators have made it possible for us to make simple some things that were tough in dentistry. We can mimic patients using them. Now that they're magnetically mountable, which all of these are, it means that they're cross-mountable. So I can do multiple mountings and have one articulator or a couple articulators. If my technician has the same articulator, they can see exactly what I see. Which brings us to transferring information. Okay, any semi-adjustable articulator works great. The one that I'm going to talk about is the SAM, although I will tell you I have used every one of these articulators working with patients, and they all produce great results. We teach with the SAM, so let's talk about the SAM articulator. The SAM articulator sitting right here, one of the things that we're going to try to accomplish by using a Facebow is to place the upper cast in that articulator in a way that's related to that hinge axis so that when I open and close, I'm actually mimicking what the patient can do. To do that, we're going to use the device called a Facebow. Okay, and this is the Facebow. This is the jig for the Facebow, and I'll just slide that on just so I can show you the relationship. Once that's on, well, it would help if I put it the right way, wouldn't it? Let's pop it on there. The blue tips are going to go in the ear because this is an earbow Facebow. There are also kinematic Facebows in which I would have to figure out where that hinge axis was, and a hinge axis Facebow, which actually lets me measure with a device where it is. Hinge axes are complex. They're tough to use because you have to make clutches. They take a lot of time. Arbitrary Facebows like kinematic and earbows actually give you 99.999% of the information you need, and with a healthy joint, I would tell you there is no decision you would make that would be clinically different if I had a hinge axis Facebow. With unhealthy joints, that could be a discussion for another time. We might want to use a hinge axis, but for this one, I would argue that for almost every case and almost every patient I see, I'm going to use one like this, an earbow, and it's what we teach. Now, to position this on the face, I have some references. All of the systems that you see here come with a device that allows me to reference. It's called a third reference point. In this case, it's this one for the SAM. It's a nasion piece. It goes on the nose. So you can imagine that if the nasion piece is set to my nose will now determine where this goes relative to my face like this. Now, great idea because it positions the model right in the middle of the articulator, but I've lost a reference. So the tip I'd like to talk about is kind of giving up that third reference point for my system. And with any system, you can do this. For instance, with a Denar earbow, it means you would not use the little device that slides in and out from the side to point to infraorbitale. I'm going to give that up. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have my patient get in position looking at horizon. And I'm going to look at their face and I want to make sure they don't tip, because as soon as you put a Facebow on somebody's face, they're going to do that because they put weight out there. So you want to look how they're faced. I'm looking at horizon. That's the same relationship that I want when I'm done with my Facebow. I might have to coach my patient to get that. I would now go in and this can be placed on the patient. You can see what's going to happen. This is going to go in the ears. The teeth are going to set right here in the bite fork in a bite registration that I would have. This one will be really loose. I can now move this around and line it up. When I line it up, I want it to be level with horizon in this plane and in this plane. And if I can accomplish that, what I've done is I've grabbed a reference. And the reference is all of these teeth relative to the floor or the bench top, which lets my technician now use that information to say, here is where that plane should be. It also lets them give me a midline that won't be canted because it will be perpendicular to that. Okay. Here's how the tip happens. Every system out there, once I record this and tighten this up, will always take this jig, and I'm going to pull the jig off and show you the jig. Every system will take this jig, and when you mount it, that jig automatically makes this, no matter where you recorded it, parallel with that upper member, every one of them. So if I have recorded this on a face where this is tipped up, it will tip the model down forward, changing the occlusal plane. we're going to recommend that that's a reference that you might want to have, because it can be really helpful if you're working with occlusal planes or incisal edges. And in many mounted cases, those are two things that are really important, because I'm changing a lot of the things that are happening there. The concept of doing that is not a new one. It does create some problems occasionally in spacing, although they're rare, because as long as we aren't going to put dye models on, we can do analysis with that. There are workarounds for those things. If you would like some other information about this, I actually just have been finishing an article that we should get up on Spear Digest soon that is going to talk about the comparison of the digital workflow to the analog workflow, which is what these are. I believe I'm going to live long enough to be able to do this digitally. I really do. But right now, I got to tell you that there's nothing better about that world. I think that might happen, because can you imagine the ability to tie together a CBCT, a movement scan, a T-scan, a rendering of how teeth touch? If you could tie all of that data together, you could look at things as they really occurred. When that's possible, I would argue analysis is really going to be something we probably will take to a digital realm. And planning. But at some point, what do we have to do? It's got to become three-dimensional, because it has to go to teeth. And I would argue that articulators are always going to have a place in what we do, because they're the thing that will allow us to take it from the two-dimensional world to the three-dimensional world. There are a number of Spear Online videos about using articulator systems. In fact, I've gone Facebow to mounting to customization with a large number of the systems that you see sitting here. So if you want to know more about Facebow, Spear Online is a great place. More about articulators also. And watch for that digest article, because it should be coming out real soon. Thanks for watching.